So hi, my name is Oleksa and I'm working as a Python developer in SoftServe. On my projects, Python was mostly used as a backend server and never as a GUI application. One day my friend came to me and asked me to create a simple accounting application for his business. He wanted it to be a simple Windows application without unnecessary complications. Python is my favorite language, so I decided to write it in Python. I started looking for the suitable framework to implement this and decided to use TKinter. And it was a success. I managed to create the first version of the application in a few days. Why did I decide to use TKinter? TKinter is de facto way in Python to create GUI and is included in all standard Python distributions. In fact, it's the only framework built into the Python standard library. TKinter is open source, so we can see the source code and update it if we need. It also has a lot of additional widgets that are also open source and can be included as Python libraries. This Python framework provides an interface to the TK toolkit and works as a thin object-oriented layer on top of TK. The TK toolkit is a cross-platform collection of graphical control elements, also known as widgets, for building application interfaces. So we can use the same code for different operational systems and expect that our application will be working the same way. It is widely used and well documented, so it's easy to figure out how to use it. And it's easy to find a solution to the issues that can appear during development TKinter application. It is also easy to use. We need just a few lines of code to create a working application, and then we can easily extend it as we need. Let's take a look at a minimal application. I used Ubuntu and Python 3.8 for this sample. To make it work, I needed just one package, Python 3.8 TK. It's very simple. A small window with standard controls, a minimal application title, and quit button. If you click that button, the window will be closed and the application will finish its work. Let's take a look at the code. We import TKinter module and rename it to TK. Our application class extends TKinter frame class and receives all its functionality. In our application class constructor, we execute frames constructor. The master parameter here refers to the parent widget. It can be omitted. In that case, TKinter will use the top level widget, which represents mostly the main window of our application. Then we call the frames grid method to make the application actually appear on the screen. Then we create a button called quit and build a command self quit, which exits the application. Then we place the button on the application frame. Set the master title to a minimal application and set the geometry or window size and position. It is a string in a special format. The four values here are width, height, left, and top, respectively. So we have width 250 pixels, height 100 pixels, left and top 0 pixels. You can skip left and top parameters and specify just width and height. In this case, the window will be located in the top left corner of the screen. So we are done with the class. Let's look at the main program. We initialize the application and execute its main loop method. It's waiting for mouse and keyboard events. TKinter has three built-in layout managers that use geometric methods to position widgets in an application frame. We shall look closer to them in the next slides. Short description: Pack organizes widgets in horizontal and vertical boxes that are limited to left, right, top, bottom positions. Each box is offset and relative to each other. Place places widgets in a two-dimensional grid using X and Y absolute coordinates. Grid locates widgets in a two-dimensional grid using row and column absolute coordinates. It is important to know that pack, place, and grid should not be combined in the same master window. Instead, choose one of these methods and stick with it.
Ed.
Sorry? Okay, let's continue. Let's take a look at this example of positioning with the pack method. In this example, we don't extend the frame class of TKinter. We just create a TK object, which refers to the main window and work with it. We create a window of 300 pixels width and height, and pack there are three labels. First, we create the label and pass the argument there. The first one is root, which is the main window, then text of the label, background and foreground. Also, we can define the font argument to make the labels bigger. After creation, we call the pack method of the label and pass argument there. The side arguments defines where the label should be packed. The pad X argument defines the horizontal padding for the label. The first label is red and it's packed to the top. And as we can see, it aligns in the center horizontally. The second label here is green and it's also packed to the top. But it was packed after the red label, so it sticks to the top of the space left. And there is a purple label. We pack it to the left with 35 pixels padding. So again, it takes the space left after the previous two labels, packing and aligns it in the middle vertically, and sticks to the left with padding 35 pixels horizontally. Let's take a look at this example of positioning with the place method. We create a window as in the previous example and create three labels, but we put them on the form using the place method. As you can see, it receives two parameters, X and Y. They are absolute coordinates and show where the top left point will be located on the parent widget. So in this picture, the first label is in the top left corner of the form. Second one is of the coordinates of 100 left and 100 top from the corner. And the last one is on the coordinates 200 left and 200 top from the corner. Looks very simple, and I use this method in my application. Let's take a look at this example of positioning with the grid method. I skipped window creation and main loop run here. They are the same as in the previous example. Here we position the labels using the grid method. The first label we put on in the zero row and zero column, and it's in the top left corner of the form. The second label is smaller than the previous one. It is in zero row and the first column and is located on the right of the first label. It is in the same row, so it's still in the top of the window, but its height is smaller, so it's aligned in the middle of this row vertically. The third label we put in the first row and first column. So it's in the same column as the previous one and is displayed under the second label. But it doesn't overlap with the first label in this case. First row is of smaller height than zero because the third label is smaller than the first. And finally, the first label we put in the second row and zero column, and it's displayed beneath zero and first rows. As it's in the zero column, it's still on the left of the form, but it's smaller than first label. So it's aligned in the center of the zero column. Before we look at the widgets, let's take a look at how some of the common attributes, such as sizes, colors, and fonts are specified. Each widget has a set of options that affect its appearance and behavior. Attributes such as fonts, colors, size, text labels, and such. You can specify options when calling the widget's constructor using keyword arguments such as text equal to panic or height equal to 20. After you created a widget, you can later change any option by using the widget's config method. You can retrieve the current setting of any option by using the widget's cget method. Dimensions. Different kinds of lengths, widths, and other dimensions of widgets can be described in many different units. If you set a dimension to an integer, like we did in our examples, it's assumed to be in pixels. But you can specify units by setting a dimension to a string containing a number followed by c centimeters, I inches, which is 2.54 centimeters, m millimeters, p printer's point. One inch is equal to 72 printer points. For example, first label we placed at the position of left 3 inches and top 216 printer points, and they are equal. The second label will be placed at the position of left 50 millimeters and top of 5 centimeters, and they are equal to. Colors. There are two general ways to specify colors in TKinter. You can use a string specifying the proportion of red, green, and blue in hexadecimal digits. And for that, you can use 3 hexadecimal digits, which is 4 bits per color. First digit is for red, the second digit is for green, and the third digit is for blue. In this example, we give 3 of 15 intensity of red color, 0 of green, and 12 of 15 of blue. And we have the violet color, close to blue because its impact is the biggest. You can make more precise colors by giving 8 bits per color. In this case, you put 2 hex digits per color, and the logic is the same as in the previous example, but we have more digits. In this example, we see a green label because we contributed only to its green component. And if you feel that this precision is not enough for your needs, you can use 12 bits or 3 digits per color. The second way is using any locally defined standard color name. The colors white, black, red, green, blue, cyan, yellow, and magenta will always be available. Other names may work depending on your local installation. You can also define your project's colors as constants and use them instead of magic numbers. Specifying fonts in TKinter. Depending on your platform, there may be up to three ways to specify type style. First way is to use a tuple whose first element is the font family followed by a size, in points if positive, in pixels if negative, optionally followed by a string containing one or more of the style modifiers, such as bold, italic, underline, or overstrike. In this example, we create a font as a tuple and it will be of times family, size 24, and it will be bold and italic. You can also create a font object by importing the font module of TKinter and using it font class constructor. In this example, we import the font module and create a font object with Arial family, size of 55 and overstriked. You can specify following arguments to the font constructor. Family, it's the font family name as a string. Size, it's the font height as an integer in points. To get a font of n pixels high, use minus n. Weight, bold for boldface or normal for regular weight. Slant, italic for italic, and Roman for unslanted, which is default. Underline, true for underlined text and false for normal, which is default. Overstrike, true for overstruck text and false for normal, which is default. And the third way is available when you run under the X Windows system. They are all Unix-like, MVS, OpenVMS, and DOS. And if you have one of these all operational systems, you can use any of the X font names. I use Ubuntu, which is Unix-like, and I can use this X font example. However, I'm not familiar with X font, so I prefer previous two methods. Fonts methods. Let's see how you can use fonts module and objects. To get a list of all font families, you can call the families method of the font module. It can be executed after you have created your root window. In my system, I received a list of 130 different font families, and I can use any of those for my fonts. The next method are of the font class. To get a list of all font options, you should call the actual method of the font object. It has an optional argument called option. So if you don't specify it, you receive a dictionary of all font attributes. If you specify a string with the option name, you will receive the value of that option. So if I call the actual method with the option equal to family, I receive a string, the family name. We can also use the common widgets method tget. In this example, I call tget method with the string weight. And if I haven't specified it, I will get the normal string. We can also update existing fonts by using the configure method. We can pass the font options with new values here. In this example, I update the font and set its family equal to times. We can also copy the font it can be useful if we want, for example, to have a basic font family for all your application, but use different size or other font styles. You can do it by calling the copy method and update the new font size later and use it for different widgets. What if you want to know how many pixels the label of the particular font will take? You can call the measure method and pass a string you want to measure as an argument there. It will return the label's length in pixels. In this example, I measure the hello string for the font of my font. But there are other font metrics that can be received by calling the metrics method. They are ascent, its number of pixels of height between the baseline and the top of the highest sender, the highest letter. Descent, number of pixels of height between the baseline and the bottom of the lowest letter. Fixed, many fonts have different size of each letter. However, there is a monospaced fonts where all symbols are of the same size. This value is false for a variable width font and true for a monospaced font. Line space. This is a number of pixels of the text line height, including distance between the lines. Anchors. The TKinter module defines a number of anchor constants that you can use to control where items are positioned to relative to their context. For example, anchors can specify where a widget is located inside a frame when the frame is bigger than the widget. These constants are given at compass points, where north is up and west is to the left. The anchor constants are shown in this diagram on the left. Anchors are also used to define where text is positioned relative to a reference point. In this example, we create a button with the submit text and pass an anchor parameter equal to northeast. And as we can see, the submit text is located in the right, top right corner. There are also other widget attributes. Relief styles represent certain simulated 3D effects around the outside of the widget. They are displayed on the first picture. Bitmaps are small pictograms that can be displayed on a widget. The standard bitmaps are displayed on the second picture. You can also put a custom image of the on the widget if you don't like these bitmaps. Geometry strings, we already used them in our examples. They define width, height, left and top coordinates of the widget. And mouse cursors, we can also define how our mouse cursor will look like over our widgets. In the last picture, a few possible mouse cursors are displayed, but they can be different for other operating systems. There are also other standard attributes, but they are rare and aren't covered in this presentation. TopLevel widget. TopLevel is a window widget. It has the window standard controls. You can create windows during the runtime. In this example, we create a root window and define a create window method. This method creates a new top level window, sets its size and a position on the screen, and then gives the focus to the new window. And then there is a button with show window text. After execution, we can see only the root window with the button. But when we click that button, a new smaller window appears beside the root window, as it's displayed on this picture. Let's take a look at a few standard widgets that we can use in our TKinter application. The first one is button. It is used to execute commands by clicking it. We already used buttons in our examples. Let's look at their most important attributes. Command attribute is needed to pass a callback function to the button widget that should be executed after clicking the button. Text is a label that will be displayed on the buttons. Button also has a few methods. Flash makes the button flash a few times. It's used to draw users' attention to it. Invoke executes the callback function passed with the command argument. The second one is the check button. It's a widget that lets the user check or uncheck some options. It has also a text and many other standard attributes. It has its own methods, select and deselect, turn on or off the check button. Invoke provides the same effect as the user clicking on the check button, but doesn't change its state. It can be used to refresh some object according to the check button selection. And the last method here is toggle. It changes the check button state. If it's on, turn it off, and it's off, turn it on. There is also a flash method which works the same way as for the buttons. Let's take a look at a few more standard widgets. The first one is Entry. It's a text area on the widget that allows the user to enter some text. It has following attributes. Show, if it's full, doesn't display the characters. It can be used for entering the passwords. Validate allows the user to bound a callback function to validate the entry text. Text variable allows to set the TKinter string var, it's type for strings, to pass the control text of the entry. You can also update that var later and see the reflection in the entry. Let's take a look at a few methods of the entry. The first one is delete. It simply deletes all the characters inside the entry. The get method allows us to receive the entry text as a string. Insert allows us to insert some text into the entry. There are also many other methods related to the entry text modification and other operations. Let's move to the next widget. It's label, one of the most simplest widgets. It allows us to display text on the widget. It has many standard attributes. The one most used is text. It reflects the label text displayed on the parent widget. There are also many other standard widgets that are not covered by this presentation. When you cannot find the widget you need for your application, it's probably already implemented in some library. You just need to find it and add it to your application. One of those widgets is date and try from the TK calendar library. It is an extended and try widget with the dropdown. When you click it, the calendar appears and you can choose whatever date you need and it will be stored in the date and try. Here's a small example. First, we install the TK calendar module. Then we import the date and try widget from there and simply add it to the page. When you execute the application, it shows a window with selected current date. But when you click on that small arrow in the right corner of the date and try, a beautiful calendar appears. And now you can select whatever date you need. In this example, I used the picture from the internet because I didn't have a tool to capture the open dropdown, but I tested it and it's working and looks similar to this picture. When you need to display or input some data in a table, you can use the sheet widget from the TK sheet module. It's a very powerful widget that has hundreds of different options. It's a TKinter analog of string grid in Delphi or the data grid view in the .NET. You can customize everything, remaining rows, renaming columns, updating the data in the runtime, disable or hide particular columns, allow or disable user editing of particular cells of the whole table, and many others. In this example, we install the TK sheet module, then import the sheet widget from it. We create a sheet with almost all standard parameters, just to show how it looks. What if you want additional functionality from the widget? You can extend it and add new functionality as you wish. You create a new class derived from that component, add or update its methods with new functionality, and use your class in your application with those features you added. In this example, we create a combo box with auto-completion. So the user can either choose the item from it using the dropdown or start typing the item name, and the combo box will suggest the item from the list. In this picture, you see that the user typed the first two letters and the combo box suggested item Australia. To accept this choice, the user needs only to press enter. And Australia will be selected. This can be very handy if you have a large list and need to scroll it down to find the interesting item. In the code on the left side, we create a new class, autocomplete combo box, derived from the widget TTK combo box, and add new methods that allow autocompletion. But this is not the whole autocomplete combo box logic. There are two more methods, and the logic there is not trivial. I don't want to dive into it in this presentation. In the code of the right, we create a window and add our new widget there and specify the list of its items. So my presentation has come to its end. Do you have any questions?